Well, good evening, everyone. It's great to see you this evening. Why don't we stand together, lift our voices together, and sing how Jesus saves.
Song of victory, Jesus saves.
Sometimes we so easily overlook the simplest of truths, like the title of that song, Jesus Saves. When all the world is looking in so many places for not just hope and joy, but they're looking for salvation, can only be found in one person. His name is Jesus. Let's sing together.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior.
To save. It's our task, since we possess the light that the world is looking for, to shine His light everywhere we go by how we live our lives. It's so important that we serve Him well. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, thank You for this moment to rejoice in Your goodness and in Your salvation that You provide for all the world. Thank You, Jesus, for dying on the cross for us, for giving us salvation and an eternal home to spend with You. I pray, Lord, that you'll speak to us tonight. Thank you for the time that we've had already in worship to lift our hearts and our minds to you and to rejoice in your goodness. But Lord, would you speak to us now in these moments? Draw us close to you. We'll be careful to give you all the praise for all that is done. It's in your name we pray. Amen. You can be seated.
Well, amen. Welcome to church. How many of you are glad it's Wednesday? Like it. Are you glad it's Wednesday because it's church night? Are you glad it's Wednesday because that means it's closer to Friday? Right? It could be, yeah, maybe a little bit of both, yeah. At least we're honest. So good to see you tonight. Let me give you some announcements, and then I'll announce my text to you, and we'll go there and study the Word together tonight. Guys, would love to have you in the morning at Cal Cafe. We will start the study at 8:15. The guys typically show up between 7:45 and 8 o'clock to eat some breakfast and fellowship a little bit, and then our study starts at 8:15. Again, if you can come, we really just share a lot together, we pray a lot together, and then we talk about our life group reading, and it's always an enriching time. How many of you have ever come to one of our Thursday mornings? Raise your hand. One of you, okay. Seen even some ladies raise their hand. No, just kidding. It's so encouraging, isn't it? And we would love for everybody to be a part of it. And it's definitely a group that I think prays for one another. And ladies, we're getting ready to start some things. Chris and I were even talking this week. We've got some ideas on some days where we can start some ladies' prayer groups and things of this nature for you as well. And then, of course, we have one of our big ladies' Bible studies coming up in the spring for you ladies. And there's a lot going on, and I think you're used to this by now. If you're not used to it, kind of get used to it. Everything we do, we want to drive the people of God to that right there. Everything we do. And that is where you say, what is the secret to the success? What's the secret sauce? You ever had something, you're like, you got to tell me what's in there. I can't put my palate on it, but like, you got to tell me what's in there. I'm telling you, the secret sauce in the Christian life is that right there. It's the Word of God. And so every time we gather, we want to just anticipate the moment that we can bring the book out. Amen? And I hope you anticipate the times throughout the day where you can just break open the Word of God. Just dive into it. It gives life. It's everything that you'd ever want. It's everything you'd ever need. And it's truth. And so I'm thankful for opportunities to do that. This coming Sunday, excited about this coming Sunday for several reasons. One, we have baptism this Sunday in the 11 o'clock service. If you are interested in being baptized, you can see me after the service, or you can contact me at the church office over the next couple of days so we can discuss that. But really excited about the folks that are going to be baptized this coming Sunday and those that will be coming to be a part of that. But also our life group luncheons, which have gone very well thus far. That will, again, be this Sunday after the 11 o'clock service. This is an opportunity for families or guests to attend a life group or even several to preview what we do in life groups and hopefully find a place and a group of people that you can belong to. So this week, it is the Far Hat Life Group, Brother Fuad's group. Brother Matt is in there as well. They will be meeting for lunch. And then the next Sunday will be Danny Hill and his life group. Okay, so encourage folks. I was sitting with a couple today that's been visiting our church and visiting with them in their home, and they were talking about just the need for community when they were looking for a church and just what they've experienced here at New Life. And they said, so tell me about life groups. And I couldn't wait to tell them about life groups because that's where you really feel like it's family. And so get plugged into a life group. I want to encourage you to do that. Tomorrow night we have a home game, a conference game. We'd love for you to come and support the Mustangs. And then we have a away game on Friday. And then save the dates. We have Newman Christian Academy's homecoming, which is always a really special night. It'll be packed. That'll be next Friday. We have a big youth rally on Saturday, January 28th. That evening here, service will be held in the auditorium. The food portion, of course, will be held in the fellowship hall, and then there's a ton of games and bonfire and stuff in the gym, and the back bonfire will not be in the gym. That would probably not be good. And then Sunday, Sounds of Praise Ensemble from Southeastern will be here. Always excited to have them. They'll be here for the youth rally as well on Saturday night. We've got, I think, five or six churches that will be here as well. So probably we'll have somewhere between 150 and 200 teenagers here that night, and excited about that, and the privilege of ministering the word to them. And then Sunday with Sounds of Praise. And then mark this on your calendar, February the 4th and the 5th. February 4th is a Saturday. February 5th is, of course, a Sunday. That is our Family Emphasis Weekend. We're doing a little bit different this year. We've been talking for weeks among our staff about ways that we could come alongside our families and try to be a help, and how it would also, you know, in turn, obviously help us. And so we have a catered meal planned on Saturday night, and so we'll be announcing some of the times. Right now it looks like it's going to be around 6 o'clock on Saturday night. Child care will be provided here for those that have small children that are not hellions. And then the rest you can utilize your family for that. But we will be eating and having a devotion time on Saturday night, and that will be held at Copper Ridge right down the road here. So Danny and those folks have been very gracious to allow us to use this for different things. And so so that will be on Saturday night. Then Sunday, I'll be preaching on the family on Sunday morning. And then Sunday night, instead of life groups, we're going to come together as a church, and we are going to have two different sections of seminars that are really geared to different elements in the family. We'll be announcing, maybe by Sunday, we'll have the list out, and so you can kind of get your mind wrapped around which session are we going to go to. So at 5 o'clock, we'll have a session from 5 to 5:45, and then we'll break for 30 minutes for a big fellowship time in the fellowship hall or the gym, depending on where we schedule our meetings at. And then that'll be from 5:45 to 6:15, just refreshments, because if we're going to get together, we need to eat. Amen? Well, maybe we don't. I mean, I don't know. I thought I had some real men in here, but maybe we don't. So we'll eat from 5:45 to 6:15, and then from 6:15 to 7, we'll have another section of breakout sessions. And I think it's going to be very enriching. We're going to try to be very different in some of the things that we're covering. It won't all be just marriage. It won't all be parenting. Some of it will be those maybe in the grandparenting years, and how to have generational discipleship. We even talked about maybe a family finances and doing one of the sessions and something like that, teaching maybe some of the principles from Ramsey that we've taught in years past. So we're going to have a lot to offer. Our staff will be teaching different ones, and several of us will be teaching in both sessions. So anyway, make plans to go ahead and carve that out that weekend. I promise you that investing time, we've been saying this all across the country with God's man, but investing time and energy and focus and intentionality with our families is important. All right? So if your family's a priority, make this weekend a priority, February the 4th and 5th, okay? So tonight, how many of you have ever had a vehicle that just pulled to one side? You know, maybe it was pulled to the left. Some of you Democrats always pulled to the left, right? Some of you Republicans, it just seems that fundamentalists always just kind of pulled to the right. And right now I've got a vehicle, and hopefully I'm going to get it to the shop and get it fixed. But it pulls hard to the right. Like, you don't even want to drive it. It's like if you take your hands off the wheel, you're going to be in, like, you know, Jones County. So this is how this has kind of played out for me. So I've been working on Wednesday night services, trying to just get ahead, at least in my thoughts, so that way when the week comes, because our weeks, everybody's weeks are just really, really busy. When our weeks come, at least I kind of know where I'm going, and then I can spend all of my energy and effort in not finding where I'm going, but what God wants to do from where He's already led me. And so I've been praying about those things and kind of laying some Wednesdays out. Of course, we know where we're going to be on Sunday mornings for the next, like, 10 years, and that's going to be the Gospel of Mark. And so that's already kind of laid out. We know we're going to be on Sunday nights with life groups. So Wednesdays, just trying to lay it out for the next 6 to 8 weeks. And every single time over the last several days, especially Monday and Tuesday, like, it's been like that car trying to drive it to where I've kind of laid it out, and I keep veering back to this. Like, no, I've already laid this out. I think I'm coming here. And it's, no, you're, I think you're coming here. And I'm sorry, but it is somewhat where we've been reading. And you know this, that I'm just going to try to always be sensitive to preach what God lays in my heart. And it's really good for me just to preach out of the overflow of what God is trying to teach me about what we've been reading for like 5 days now. And so the reason I wasn't going to speak on it today is because some of the staff that's in here that are in our school, they were in chapel yesterday, and I actually spoke on a portion of this in chapel to our middle school and then in our high school chapel. And I'm like, well, they've already heard it, so I'm just going to go over here. And like even as late as this afternoon, God's like, no, you're not. You're going to stay right here because not only do teenagers need to hear this, but we need to hear this. Erica knows where I'm going. She was in there. It's like, okay, you guys, y'all need it, right? It's good? Okay, good. I appreciate that vote of confidence. I'm feeling better already. I want to give you three words, and throughout the message, you're going to have to repeat these words with me when I prompt you, okay? Don't just do it randomly. That would be weird, all right? So I'll prompt you with these three words. And the words that I want you to repeat after me throughout the message is not just words, but it's just a truth that we need to remember every second of our life. Anybody here live your life based on a calendar? By the way, I have to. And even when I live based on the calendar, I still forget stuff. Man, I like put everything on my calendar. I'm like, how did I forget that? It's right there 8 times, and I still forgot it. There's some things that you can, that it's okay to forget, and then you'll just hit it the next day. Because that's what I'll do. If I forget it, I'm not leaving the things I didn't get done today, I'm not leaving in Wednesday on my calendar. Guess what? Before I go to bed, I'm hitting that. I'm changing the date, changing the time, because sometime tomorrow, I've got to take care of that. And some things, some things on my calendar, it's like Frogger. It just keeps hopping day to day to day until I finally get it done. So, because there's some things you can afford to delay, you can afford to forget, and eventually it'll come back. I'm telling you, this truth, what we're going to recite several times tonight, it's vital for us to remember every single second of our life. Because that's how quickly it can change. And here is the three words. Choices have consequences. Choices have consequences. Now, we're going to start tonight in Genesis chapter 3. But we're actually going to talk all the way to Genesis chapter 19, which is what we read today. Because if there's one theme that we've seen from Genesis 3 to Genesis 19, it's these three words. Say it with me. Choices have consequences. So tonight, if I were to entitle the message, I would simply entitle it, The Power of a Choice. The Power of a Choice. So what do we have in Genesis 1 and 2? We have the most detailed account, the most detailed record of creation. We know and believe that God created all things. See that. And then he begins to question God's motives and put to test Eve's commitment to follow truth, where he says, well, because God knows if you eat of it, then you're going to be like him. You're going to be like a God because you're going to know right and wrong. Now, by the way, in everything Satan does, there's always enough truth in it. If I were to ask a question tonight. Have you ever met someone who is manipulative? Everybody here would say that. My fear in asking that is I'm afraid if I ask that, some of you might look at somebody here. I won't do that. But every one of us knows what it's like to know somebody who manipulates. No one manipulates more than Satan. He's the king of it. Jesus said he's the father of lies. And so we know that Satan is now testing and tempting, so much so that in Genesis chapter 3, verse 6, the Bible says, "And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat." If you write in your Bibles, I want you to write these words beside that verse. I want you to write four words beside that verse. You ready? Here it is. They had a choice. They had a choice. God commanded them. The word commandment is first used in chapter 2 in this sense that God commanded them. You can eat of every tree but that one. So don't eat of it. And now she's in the midst of the garden. Now we would say, like, why? If the only tree that you could not partake of was in the midst of the garden, why are you in the midst of the garden? Right? I mean, think about it. Like the Garden of Eden wasn't like the size of this auditorium. Like the Garden of Eden, I think, was a lot bigger than we give it credit for. She was in, hear me, church, she was in the midst of the garden on purpose. She didn't just come by the midst of the garden. Oh, there's that tree we're not supposed to eat. She's close enough where Satan is having a conversation and it continues to catch her eye. But now she stands before that tree. She gives heed to the temptation. She makes a choice. Adam makes a choice. And everything changed. Everything changed. Do you know why? Say it with me. Because choices have consequences. Because choices have consequences. They made a choice. And they suffered because of it. The first thing I want us to see tonight in this text, if you were to ask, what was their choice? Their choice was not to obey. Their choice was to disobey. I mean, you understand with the precepts and the commandments and the law and the judgments of God, like you and I are confronted every day that we're in the Scriptures, you and I are confronted with choices. And the choice we have every day, every single day, the choice is to obey or to disobey. That's the choice. They chose. I can't just throw her under the bus, even though I'd like to. They chose to disobey. That was their choice. And notice the consequences. The Bible says in verse 7, and the eyes of both of them were opened. Like, you understand that consequences for sin, small or great, the consequences begin immediately, whether you realize it or not. Maybe you would admit it, because I certainly would. There have been things I've done that I thought, you know what, a few days later, a few weeks later, even a few months later, I'm like, you know what, I got away with it. No, the Bible tells me that consequences always start immediately. Or for them, their eyes were open immediately. I mean, can you imagine the revelation of that? They ate of that fruit and automatically their eyes were open. And by the way, think of the challenge that I had reading these verses in middle school yesterday. It's like, anyway, all right? Their eyes were, of them were both open, and they knew that they were naked. And the Bible says, and they sewed fig leaves together and made aprons, and then they heard the voice of God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of God. Like, how immediate are these consequences? Because here's some things we know. When we choose to disobey God, first of all, the consequences begin immediately. Secondly, the second thing that happens, we immediately try to cover it up. We try to hide our sin. We don't want anybody to know. We don't want God to know. Maybe I can conceal it from God. Are you serious? Consequence number three, my unconfessed sin always, and by the way, I'm using big and emphatic words, my sin always drives me away from God. This is a voice that I believe before this moment they were running to. And now it's a voice they're running from. This is the one, their creator, that they had no doubt had powerful, incredible, amazing, intimate moments with, and now they're afraid of them. The Bible says that they ran from the presence of God to hide themselves, notice, amongst the trees. He'll never find us here. Verse 9, and the Lord called unto Adam and said, where art thou? Look, I preached this text so many times to y'all. You know what I'm about to say. God didn't ask the question because God didn't know. I wonder where Adam is. God asked the question not for God's benefit. God asked the question for Adam's benefit. God confronts us with our sin, not because it makes God feel better. God confronts us with our sin so that you and I will know exactly where we are. Where are you, Adam? Of course, then I read this comically. Verse 10, and he said, I heard thy voice. This is Adam. I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked. And I hid myself. And God said, who told you you were naked? And Adam's like, cat's out of the bag. I just told everything. Who told you? Adam, have you eaten of the fruit that I, notice, hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest eat? Did you? Adam said, well, God, it was actually that woman. By the way, can I say this? Transferring of guilt is also a consequence of sin. Because consequences start immediately. We then try to cover up our sin. It always drives us from the presence of God. And we immediately start looking for somebody else to blame. You know what sickens me about this culture sometimes? That no one is guilty. And that everyone's a victim. And I just want you to know something. And if you get mad at me, Brother Earl Dale told me to say this. You are not a victim. You are guilty. I am not a victim. I'm guilty. You want to be countercultural? Take the word victim out of your vocabulary. Just take it out. And realize that we are nothing but sinners saved by grace. Right? Lord, I'm the victim. This woman that was supposed to be my, I can see him now, help meet. Oh, she really did me a solid this time. Oh, and by the way, God, I hate to bring this up at such an awkward time, but you're the one who gave her to me. Adam better be glad that I am not God. Because I'd be like, then the eyes of God goes to Eve. Eve, is this true? What did Eve do? Same thing. It was a serpent. She was pointing the finger at the serpent. And then God went to the serpent. And the serpent didn't have any fingers. You ever thought about that? So then what did God do? He began to usher out consequences. The Bible told the woman that we would know after this is Eve. The Lord said unto the woman, what is this that thou hast done? Verse 13, the woman said unto the serpent, God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. You'll crawl around your belly. And of course we said, well, that wasn't a big deal because Satan was just possessing that, or he had just kind of created that. And so now a species is getting the consequence of the real enemy. No, the real enemy is going to get his consequence. There's a place called hell reserved just for him. Right? There'll be enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. And it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Aren't you glad that God was already prophesying that Jesus would come and be the remedy for all this? And one day there's going to come a man. He's the Son of Man and the Son of God all at the same time. And I can't wrap my mind around it, but the Bible teaches it, and it's true. And he is going to crush the head of the serpent. He's going to be victorious. But then to the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Consequences. And unto Adam, because thou hast hearkened, or hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. Which means, Adam, hey, by the way, everything that came to you easy in the garden, now you're going to have to work hard for it. Adam, nothing's coming easy anymore. It's your consequence. You're going to have to labor in sorrow. Curses the ground for thy sake. In sorrow thou shalt eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee. And thou shalt eat of the herb of the field. Everyone suffered consequences. That wasn't all. But then they were cast out of the garden. And the garden was hidden from humanity. But not only that, but sin had now entered into the world. Now, can we rewind just for a minute? What if we had presented all that to Eve in that moment before she took that fruit off that tree? What if we said, hey, Eve, before you do this, don't forget, church, say it with me, choices have consequences. I wonder what she would have done. See, Satan was so busy maximizing the blessings and the benefits of her taking this fruit, he ignored the consequences. Did I mention now that Adam and Eve were dead in their trespasses and sin. And they would taste death because God said, you will surely know what it is to die. And they did. They made a choice to disobey. And there was consequences. But then there are others. They're embodied, in my opinion, in the third word of the chapter. Now the serpent. Now we know this was not just an average snake. We know this is Satan. Satan, if you know, was created by God. Which, by the way, can we just say this? If you want to remind Satan of something, remind him that he is a created being. He is not the Alpha and the Omega. He is not the beginning and the end. He is not the first and the last. He is not the Almighty. He is not omniscient. He is not omnipotent. He is not omnipresent. He is not eternal. He is not sovereign. You know why? Because he's not God. And when we're intimidated by Satan, and we need to make sure we understand he is a formidable foe, but he's not God. He's not God. And so we see this angel. What was the origin of this angel? Well, we know that his name originally was Lucifer. We know that he was one of the, if not the most powerful, of all the angels created. We know that he was in some ways in charge of music and worship. He was Brother Kevin. That's who he was. That was mean. But this powerful, supernatural, amazing sidekick of heaven wanted to be God. And was so manipulative that he convinced a third of the angelic host to rebel against God. You could say that those angels, at least in a time, angels had a free will because they made a choice. And when you make a choice, if you'll remember, class, choices have consequences. They were cast out of heaven. Some are still bound in hell until the tribulation time, when God will release them for a small period of time and then will bind them in the lake of fire forever. And now there are others that are running to and fro in this world. They are principalities and powers in this world that we cannot even fathom or understand. It is darkness that is covering like a cloud this globe. And they are supernatural in nature. And they are enemies of you and they are enemies of God. And yet one day, they will suffer their ultimate consequence. Because choices, when you rebel against God. See, some of you tonight, you've made a choice. You've made choices to disobey God. God's told you to do this, and you've done this. God's told you to say this, and you've said this. Or God's told you to not say this, and you keep saying it. God's told you to tell the truth, and you tell lies. You continue to disobey. God's told you to treat your wife a certain way, or ladies, treat your husband a certain way. God has commanded you to be this kind of parent, and you're being this kind of parent. God's told you to live with an open hand and to be generous, and you've lived with a closed fist and you're just as tight as you can be. God's told you to give and you keep. God's told you to be honest and you steal and you lie. You're living in disobedience and you think you're getting away with it. Hear me. Choices have consequences. Or tonight you're living in rebellion. I know what that's like. I know what it's like to be a rebel. I was a rebel. I invented rebel. I was a teenager. I was such a rebel that on my extended cab, two-wheel drive, had four tires. Extended cab, Ford Ranger, 1991, burgundy, gray stripe on the side, CB antenna, fire station antenna. I wasn't even in the fire department, but it looked cool. Tinted windows, system in the back, 0 to 60 in 4 miles. My license plate on my truck said, "The Rebel." I was bad. I really was. And some of you, we dignified Sodom and Gomorrah. And Lot tries to protect them by even offering to those perverts his own daughters. And then these angels blinding these sodomites and telling Lot, "You got to get out." By the way, if you didn't read it good, go back and read it again. And yet they almost had to drag Lot out of there. Because hear me, guys, you can make so many choices of disobedience and choices of rebellion and choices of just not listening that before you know it, that's just become a part of who you are. And you almost have to be drug out of your mindset and drug out of your situation and drug out of your city, just like Lot was. Even when he went to his son-in-law and his older daughters, they laughed at him because he thought they were joking, because Lot had even lost his testimony because of all these choices so many years previous, where he pointed his life and his legacy towards Sodom and the world. And now he's suffering the consequences. So much so that when they were leaving and God told him not to look back, that his wife turned around and looked, and Jesus even referenced the fact that she was turned into a pillar of salt. Jesus said, "Remember Lot's wife?" And then fire and brimstone. By the way, the angels told Lot, "Now I want you to go into the mountain." And Lot said, "No, I don't want to go to the mountain. Let me go to this city." Like, Lot, get it through your thick skull. You are not the best leader. Listen. "Now I'm going to go to Zoar." And then after he was there for a while, he's like, "You know what? I think I'm going to go to the mountains." That's where God was leading you to begin with. But then when he got there, you know what his daughters did? They got him drunk so that his seed could be preserved. And they committed immorality with their own dad. And you look at the generations that were born on those sinful nights. By the way, you really want to ask me what good can come from alcohol? That's for another sermon. Nothing. You say, "Well, how did they get there?" You ready? Choices. And we are reliving these things by reading it from the Scriptures. And my heart today was grieved over and over again because I see it lived out in the Bible, I see it lived out in my life, and I see it lived out in the people that I love. Because here's a truth that you better never forget, but you cannot deny. Say it with me. Choices have consequences. And so what do we need to do? We need to make better choices. Because even though that sounds always negative, it's not always negative. Because if you sow good seed, you'll reap good fruit too. Amen? If you sow obedience, you'll reap blessing. You sow disobedience, you'll reap cursing. And can I say this? You will not only reap these things, good or bad, in your life, but I'm telling you that fruit is generational. Some of you right now, you're kind of cruising through. And it may, hear me, it may barely work out for you. But it's going to be devastating for your children and grandchildren. Because choices have consequences. So what do we need? We need to be Christians that are determined with God's help. And don't we need God's help? Christians that are determined to live a life with spirit-filled discernment for every choice. Whether you think it's a small choice or a big choice, may we beg God to give us the grace and the strength to have the necessary determination and the necessary discernment to be able to make godly choices in everything. In your Christian life, in your home, in your business, in all your relationships, public decisions, and hear me, in private ones too. God, I'm determined with your help to live with a spirit-filled discernment in every decision. Why is that so important? Last time. Because choices have consequences. I'm just about for prayer. Invitation simple. Tonight you're here and you'd say, preacher, I'm determined with God's help to live with spirit-filled discernment in my decision making. That's my commitment before God. If that's you tonight, I want you just to leave your seat right now. And I want you to find a spot on this altar. I want you to say, God, that's who I want to be. I want to live a life guided by the benevolent hand of the Holy Spirit. I want to be so filled with truth. I want to have such a love for righteousness. Oh, that God would keep us in His perfect will. Father, give us clarity. Remove the cloud from our thinking. And manifest the light of truth upon every decision. We watch, to what we listen to who we spend time with, to what we fill up our day with, to how we spend our money, to what we entertain in our thoughts, to the words that come out of our mouth. To our doctrine, our philosophy, our mission. Give us spirit-filled discernment. So bless us as a church. Guide us as a church. Minister to our families. And help this truth to be in our thoughts, to be in our conscience. And we're going to praise you in advance. We love you. In Jesus' name. All God's people said, thank you for being here tonight, and I hope when you leave, I hope you will keep these things on your heart and mind, and may God use His Word to continue to guide us. Amen, church. Amen. Let's stand, shake some hands, and have a great night. Consider yourself dismissed.